team our lectures to join in and this opening of the joint ISTP IEA workshop on the physics and technology of the innovative nuclear energy system. So now we still have not, I believe, not all people who can join, but I hope they will join us when we come from the introduction to the other lectures. So first of all, I'd like to thank ISTP organization team, and especially Sandro, for this, again, perfect organization of the of this workshop. And we always in the IEA really enjoy this cooperation with ISTP, and we do it actually our workshop on innovative nuclear energy systems every 2 years almost. And up to now we are happy, and we are also happy with organization, with good organization of this workshop organized by ISTP. As you know, to attend this workshop, you had to, participants had to fulfill several steps and to satisfy the criteria that you should prove that your background, your expertise, and present a poster, an abstract for the poster session, which we'll have later. Now I come to the agenda. Maybe you all have this program in your, and we will follow this program day by day. Normally we have main lectures in the morning and afternoon. We will have some group activities, some poster sessions, and other things, including this. It's not shown here, but it should be today, get together drink, which I believe a dinner, what we will see this evening. Okay, but this program agenda is pretty flexible. We can change, plus I think within this agenda, especially for the group activities, we can rearrange and we can change. And as you know, that you are all divided in 4 groups, maybe we can rearrange later, and we will have the so-called group activities and home walks, not only to swim in the beautiful sea, but also to do some group activities to learn how to work in team, in temporary teams, to solve the tasks and to solve the scientific problems or engineering problems that we arranged here. So now, before we go to the self-introduction for everybody, let me show you our lectures. I have a great pleasure to introduce Professor Massimo Salvadores, who is attending our workshop already several times, and he is his background. Now he's working as a consultant in Idaho National Laboratory, but he was spent all his life on doing this work on the innovative energy system, mainly in the CIA France, in CIA Cadarache, as a head of reactor and fuel cycle physics division and research director in there. And Massimo was leading several international studies on innovative fuel cycles and scenarios. In 2002, he was awarded Grand Prix Empereur for the French Academy of Science, and also Wigner Award of the American Nuclear Society as well in 2005. He is a fellow of American Nuclear Society and member of International Nuclear Energy Academy. And he is the founder, actually, of the International Summer School Reactor Physics Frédéric Joliot Otto Hahn, which now is taking place in where? This year? In Cadarache. And Massimo will leave us on Wednesday, I believe. Oh. On Wednesday to join the school again. So we are happy that he agreed to make his presentation on our event in the beginning of this week. He has numerous papers and presentations and works on physics. So thank you, Massimo, to join us today and this week. Another our lecture, very important this time, still working actively in CIA France, is Christian Laget, who graduated in chemical engineering from National Polytechnic Institute de Toulouse. And he was involved in all French projects on the sodium-cooled fast reactors, which are SuperPhoenix, Phoenix, Astrid, both versions of Astrid. And he is responsible and he is expert in sodium technology and other things. And many other things, but main his expertise, and he will Christian will deliver lectures to us on the sodium technology mainly, and also the current and recent update on the status of the Astrid program, I believe. Okay. So, and Christian is teaching in INSTN and several other universities. Welcome, Christian. Great to see you again here. And another our new lectures is Professor Ichimiya. So Ichimiya sensei, well, now he's a consultant in the Department of Nuclear Engineering and Management School of Engineering of the University of Tokyo. He was for a long period of time, he was director of the Fast Breeder Reactor Engineering Center of the JAEA in ORI. By the way, I was also that time in ORI working a couple of years there. And he is a professor, former professor at the Research Institute of Nuclear Engineering and University of Fukui. He has a long professional experience also on all Japanese fast reactor programs, including Monju, which is now under decommissioning, and also JSFR and other projects, JOYO and other. And Ichimiya sensei published four books, one for structural design of nuclear facility and three for fast reactors. And recently he again published a book on fast reactor system design, and he will deliver on the reactor designs and other related issues several lectures on this workshop. Konstantin Mikityuk is also now very active in GIF and other European projects on innovative nuclear energy system, especially, of course, on the sodium-cooled fast reactors. He's working in GIF actively and also including teaching. And he is a coordinator and leader of the Horizon 2020 project called ESFR Smart. He will explain the project and its structure and other things. Konstantin represents Switzerland. He's from PSI. I forgot to notice, by the way. Paul Scherrer Institute in Switzerland, and here Konstantin represents Switzerland at Generation 4 International Forum Expert Group and in the IAEA Technical Working Group on Fast Reactors also. And another new lecture is Professor Adrian Buis, I believe, and I didn't see Adrian, he's not here yet, but he'll join us later, as he said. And he is from McMaster University from Canada. And his main major specialist is the nuclear reactor core physics of existing designs such as CANDU reactors and research reactors at Canadian Nuclear Laboratories. And actually, before coming to Canada, Adrian was professor in experimental particle physics at Utrecht University, participated in experiments in the collider in the Switzerland also, I believe, in CERN, and designed experiments of the Large Hadron Collider. And now he's a professor, as I say, and he's expert also on molten salt cooled reactors, and he'll present several lectures on this. Again, Dr. Galina Fisenko, representative of the International Atomic Energy Agency. She is working since 2013 in the IAEA on international project on innovative nuclear reactors and fuel cycles, what we call INPRO. Galina will explain in the details what this INPRO project is and give you also some exercises on the methodology. She is a scientific secretary for several collaborative projects on scenarios for sustainable nuclear energy development, and she is responsible for many publications in the IAEA. And one of her achievements, she was awarded in 2017 for her outstanding performance in the agency. Before joining the IAEA, she worked for more than 20 years contributing to nuclear physics education and science in Obning Technical University for Nuclear Power Engineering, which is also my home university as well. And Galina, welcome to Trieste, and I'm sure you will deliver good presentations for us. Finally, we have organizers from the IEA. This is Mr. Chirayu Batra. Chirayu, right? Okay. And he is also working in the IEA since 2015 as a nuclear engineering fast reactor technology development team. He got double Master of Science degree from the UPS Barcelona Technical University and ISCN Saclay in 2013. And he was working here for the fast reactors engineering for our team for 5 years, or generally for, no, not for 5 years. Generally in the field of nuclear engineering and fast reactor technology. He is the president of the UN Nuclear Young Generation Council, or United Nations Nuclear Young Generation Organization. And also, I know, which I missed to insert here, but he was, this year he was awarded for outstanding performance special award from the IEA for his really outstanding performance, which I definitely confirm. And my name is Vladimir Kevintsev. Since 2016, I am also working in the IEA, in the fast reactor technology development team, as it's, I have a pleasure to lead this team. And from historic, I got my PhD from Obninsky Institute of Nuclear Engineering in 1994. Then I got another one, Doctor of Engineering, from Tokyo Institute of Technology. And I was working in several programs on nuclear engineering in IPPA, Tokyo Institute of Technology, in GNC, ORA Engineering Center, in INP again, and KIT in Germany, Karlsruhe Institute of Technology, before I joined the IEA. Okay, now, before we continue, I continue my presentation, I would like our participants to introduce themselves and just to say, please, your name, where you're coming from, what is your main major and specialty, and your impression and your wishes, whatever you want, just your self-introduction. And we maybe start, how do we start? We start from that. Excuse me. Okay, please. Yeah, please, please go, let's we go. Yes, please. I think we, can you please, there's a microphone.
Hi everyone, I'm Huda El Yaqoubi. I'm a PhD student from Morocco, Tetouan. I pursue in my thesis on modelization and calculation of some neutronic parameters of NHR5 nuclear reactor. Nice to meet you.
Hello everyone, good morning. My name is Sam Milhem, I'm from Jordan. I'm working at Jordan Atomic Energy Commission. I'm the head of small modular reactors in Jordan. Thank you.
Could you give to, before. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Vulcu Andrei. I'm from Romania, and I currently work at the Institute for Nuclear Research in Pitești, and I study mainly about lead-cooled fast reactors on chemistry and thermal hydraulics. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Pablo Bellino from Argentina, and I work in Argentina National Commission Center, and my main topic is experimental physics dedicated to research and production reactors. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Janet Ademola from Nigeria, University of Ibadan, Department of Physics. I teach students reactor and health physics. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. My name is Elena Rodina. I am from Russian Federation. I am working for Project Prorykt in the Department of Scientific Advisor. Project Prorykt was established by State Corporation Rosatom for the development of fast reactor operating in the closed nuclear cycle. My personal responsibility researches of fast reactor cores features of reactors. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Evgeny Shabelnikov. I'm from Russia. I'm working at Institute of Nuclear Materials, and my topics experimental testing of advanced nuclear materials. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. My name is Maxim Malovitsa. I'm a PhD student of VN Karazin, Kharkiv National University, Ukraine. And I'm working with nuclear burn-in wave reactors. And I'm looking forward to lectures and group exercises. Thank you.
Hello, everyone, and good morning. Myself, Bachchan Avitav, working as a scientific officer in Indira Gandhi Center for Atomic Research, Kalpakkam, India. My main interest in the reactor physics is fast reactor core neutronics and its safety studies. Thank you.
Good morning to all. I am Rajkumar, working in Indira Gandhi Center for Atomic Research. Basically, I'm a mechanical engineer working in design and development of fast reactor fuels, particularly oxide fuels and metal fuels. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Anurag Samantra. I'm from India. I'm working in Indira Gandhi Center for Atomic Research in Department of Atomic Energy in India. I work in thermal hydraulics of sodium cooled fast reactor. Especially I work in decay heat removal systems, that is passive safety systems of fast reactor.
Hello everyone, my name is, I'm a doctor. Recently I got my PhD connected with closed nuclear fuel cycle in Russia, connected with the PRIV. Project supported by Rosatom. I wrote the reprove code, and which I will present in my poster presentation. Some advertisement, sorry. Thank you for invitation on this seminar. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Andrea Bersano from Politecnico di Torino in Italy, and my research is on passive heat removal system, both from the experimental side and for numerical code simulations.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Borja González, and I am coming from Spain, but working in the Belgian Nuclear Research Center in the MIRA project. And I am working in the R&D part of the reactor, in the chemistry of the coolants, mainly in the radiochemistry and evaporation of different products from LBE. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Sofia Kolovi. I'm from Greece. I've studied physics and specialized in nuclear physics, and now currently I'm doing my master's in nuclear energy.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Marco Caramello, and I work for Ansaldo Nucleare, is the nuclear company in Italy. And I used to work for several years for fast reactor development, both for the MIRA project, and now I am in the design team for the Alfred reactor, and I work in thermal hydraulics and safety.
Hi everyone, good morning. My name is Alejandro Campos, I'm from Mexico, and I am doing my master's studies in the development of neutronic codes for hexagonal reactor geometries.
Hello everyone, I'm Stefano Dalla Vecchia from Italy, and I am currently a master's student studying in Grenoble material science for nuclear energy.
Hi everyone, my name is Pedro Moreno, I'm from Spain, and I'm also studying my master's degree, but I will study in Paris operations.
My name is Mark Sherfong. I work for Canadian Nuclear Safety Commission. I'm a project officer there. Before joining CNSC, I was working at a power generation companies.
Hello everyone, I'm Elektra Poulopoulou from Greece.
And I'm currently doing my PhD at the Nuclear Engineering Department of the National Technical University of Athens. And my PhD is about computational modeling of an experimental thermal hydraulic setup that simulates the phenomena that happen in a nuclear fuel channel. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. My name is Mai from Vietnam. I'm teaching reactive physics in Hanoi University of Science. I study the utilizations of the thorium fuel in the ADS system and also the minor actinide transmutations. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. My name is Alexey Lankevich. I'm from Russia. I'm working in IPPP in Obninsk. I'm engineer researcher in the area of supercritical water-cooled reactor. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. I'm Rebecca Thorington from the United Kingdom. I'm a chemistry specialist working at the Office for Nuclear Regulation. So we're responsible for regulating the civil nuclear industry in the UK. We're currently preparing to preparing our understanding to develop advanced nuclear technologies, and I'm looking specifically at molten salt reactors and high-temperature gas reactors.
Good morning, my name is Elspeth McGregor. I'm also from the UK, from the Office for Nuclear Regulation. I'm a chemistry specialist and part of our advanced nuclear technologies team.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Afshin Hedayat from Iran. I was graduated in PhD of Nuclear Reactor Engineering from Tehran Polytechnic in 2009, and today I'm an assistant professor of the Reactor and Nuclear Safety School of Nuclear Science and Research Technology Institute of Atomic Energy Organization of Iran.
Hello, everyone. Good morning. My name is Niloufar. I'm from Iran. And now I'm working at Nuclear Science and Technology Research Institute from Atomic Energy Organization of Iran. And thank you for this opportunity.
Hello, everyone. I'm Bahar Rustai. I'm from Iran. I'm working in NSTRI of Iran. I'm studying about modeling of thermomechanical of nuclear fuel under irradiation. Thank you.
Hi there, I'm Connor Pashke. I'm from the UK. I'm a master's student currently studying nuclear energy, and I'm very glad I can finally put a face to Chirayu's name now.
Thanks. Thank you. Okay, thank you, everybody, for a nice introduction. And also, it's great to see that we have young generation of nuclear engineers coming from around the world. First of all, of course, the main, let's say, innovative or fast reactors, countries like Russia, India. France is not represented, Christian. It's your fault also, you see. Do we have anybody from France? No. This is a big mistake also. I will take note on this the next time. But because probably of the school which Massima organized, unfortunately, at the same time as our meeting here, but also from the all around the world, from the newcomer countries, and also like from the UK, let's say old comers, I know, the countries who are again starting to study and to introduce these innovative reactor systems again. And welcome to Trieste. This is really great, nice place to to have a workshop here. And I hope you will all enjoy, and you will get also not only enjoy the sea, but also get some knowledge from the best experts, almost best experts. I mean, not all of them, but most are here in this week in Trieste to give us lectures on the innovative nuclear systems. Okay, now I come back to my presentation, and I want to briefly explain what is the International Atomic Energy, what's our goals, mandate, and assistance to the member states. Let me start with a brief.
Organization assists countries with their energy planning. If they choose nuclear power, it offers expertise to ensure facilities are run safely and securely. It provides standards and assistance to ensure the safe use of radioactive materials, guidance on the management of the waste generated by the use of nuclear technologies, and helps nations to prepare for and respond to incidents and emergencies. It's an agency that prevents the spread of nuclear weapons by helping to make sure that nuclear materials remain in peaceful uses. It's the global platform for cooperation in nuclear security, advising countries how to guard against nuclear terrorism and prevent the theft and smuggling of radioactive materials. Providing technology and expertise. Promoting safety and security. Assisting sustainable development. This is Atoms for Peace and Development. This is the IAEA.
Okay, so as you see from this brief introduction, our main goal is Atoms for Peace and, can you hear me? Atoms for Peace and Development, which means the agency provides technology on nuclear power to all countries who want to adopt to use this atomic energy for peaceful uses. And also another task is to prevent proliferation of the nuclear weapons and to restrict, I mean, these technologies only by peaceful use. In this view, we have several working areas, which is what we are working now. It's nuclear energy, which I am, our department is of nuclear energy, and we are working for this. And this workshop is organized by the Department of Nuclear Energy. Another is nuclear science and applications, Department of Technical Cooperation, which supports developing countries for specific projects. Another department is Department of Nuclear Safety and Security, which obviously works in the field of the or area of the nuclear safety and security. And one very important department is the safeguards, which is responsible for the safeguards of the nuclear facilities and verification and ensuring the non-proliferation tasks. But we are here, so our Department of Nuclear Energy is relatively small, and it is responsible for Atoms for Peace and Development in terms that we provide the technology and expertise to the countries who want to adopt and to use nuclear power for the peaceful purposes. If you go in numbers, that IAEA was organized in 1957, so it's already 62 years of the international service. Now we have 168 member states, which are almost all countries on this planet except North Korea, which suspended their participation like 20 years ago. And altogether, we have in the agency about 2,500 professional and supporting staff. Our regular budget is about 360 million euros. It was like data for 2016. And we have also extra budgetary voluntary contributions from our member states. It's about 50 million. In addition to that, we have also voluntary contributions to the Technical Cooperation Fund, which is estimated also in 2016 as about 90 million euros. And this is about the money, what the budget, with member states supporting the agency in its activity. We have 12 international laboratories, scientific laboratories, and research centers in different places. And we are gathering about more than 1 million documents, technical reports, standards, conference proceedings, journals, and books in the IAEA library. So, one of the goals and our goals of the IAEA, the they coincide and they're guided by the main goals of the United Nations, so-called United Nations 17 Sustainable Development Goals, which are several, altogether 17, and what we are doing with IEA to support at least 8 of those goals are supported by the agency. Let me show briefly you, let's say, what is the status of the energy in 2017. You see on this map that in the developing country, it's a view, let's say, artificial. It's not, of course, view, but this is like what you can see from the space if it's, of course, a little bit adjusted, the picture. You see the developed countries and lights on there. And you see the most energy is concentrated and produced and used now in the several developing countries, while 1.3 billion people of this planet population have no access to the energy. 1 billion people have no access to the health care due to the energy poverty. And half, 2.6 billion people here rely on biomass, or I mean, on very primitive and simple sources of the energy. And we believe that this should be changed, and the our goal to change this, and this is why we have this several goals for sustainable development, which we want to try to help countries to fulfill and go. So, first goal, which we also supported by, is food safety and insect pest control, which is important from the nuclear applications, livestock population, group improvement, and water and soil management. This is, we fight against the hunger in this planet. Another goal is to health, to improve the health. It means prevention of cancer, which nuclear energy provides several types of instrumentation or means to fight it, and for nuclear medicine and radiation oncology, and zoonotic disease monitoring and nutrition also. So goals 7 and 9 are related closely to our department goals also, and we are working on this more carefully. And this is energy planning, introduction of nuclear powers to the newcomer countries, and we also supporting development of the and understanding also of the nuclear fuel cycle, which should be developed. We also do support the development of the research reactors. It could be the first stage in deployment of the nuclear energy. And we also support the industrial applications of the nuclear energy, not only like producing electricity, but other industrial applications as well. Goals, sustainable goals of the United Nations 6 and 14 is clean water and sanitation, and also life below water. So this is all related to the water and management of the water resources and other activities related to the protection of water. So the climate actions, life on land. As you know, that the climate change, which is very, this is a serious problem that was observed and started to deal with like 20 or 15 years ago, maybe. And we have really that observation, the scientists provided this climate is changing, not only temperature growth or like global warming, now is climate change in general. And in this case, of course, nuclear energy, as we are carbon free, or as you understand that nuclear power does not produce CO2, can contribute a lot, and that's what we want. And now, for the our department, we have so-called innovation technology development. We publish in the agency many, many documents, which are very, let's say, provide full scope of information on nuclear power, nuclear energy, and its use. And it starts from the big documents like, for example, a resolution of the General Conference, and continue to the very different type, from very general for the policymakers, I would say, up to very specific documents, which is related to the technical aspects of what we are providing there. So, and this slide shows, it's a description for our presentation, what makes nuclear power unique, or compared to other power, mean unique, and also, I would say, difficult. So it needs long-term government commitment, first of all. And also, in addition, compared to the other sources of power, it needs long-term nuclear waste management. This is unique, I know, like foreign, this is not my words. It's a standard, let's say, description of what is different nuclear power, why we need government for this, and why we need long-term thinking, not short-term thinking. However, the other sources of power not considered, for example, from the waste management. Do you consider how do you manage the waste if you introduce hydropower, let's say, and does it produce the waste? In principle, it looks not, but if you know that it will change the landscape, it will remove the people, you have to remove the people, especially in big countries like India and China, to build big power plant. And I believe in China, there is the biggest power plant, hydropower plant, which 30 gigawatt electric. But then to build this, you have to relocate about 5 million people from their places where they used to live. And as a waste management, imagine that if something happens with this, how do you manage the consequences of this waste? Water, I know. So, but nevertheless, for the nuclear energy, we know from the very beginning that we should consider this. When you produce electricity, we also produce the waste, and we should take care of this. And we are doing and considering from the very beginning how to manage and how to do. We understand clearly what we are doing. So you also should manage the investment of the capital for this, because it will pay back, I don't know, you have to wait 10, 15, maybe 20 years, unless this project will pay back. And not everybody can invest in this way. In addition, we in nuclear energy, we need well-trained human resources. They must be very responsible and very well-trained to get to be able to work on the nuclear power plant, because we want to provide the highest safety standards for this. And this is, well, we need well-trained resources to provide a high level of safety and security. And also, we should use special safeguard and control of nuclear materials. And finally, we should win the public acceptance of the nuclear power plant, which is a long story, and we are, in many cases, we are losing. We cannot assure the public that nuclear energy is safe, and we have examples, but okay. That makes it very difficult, I mean, different from other sources to introduce. So this slide shows briefly the general state of the, it's actually 2 years maybe ago or something. So how many energy was generated? We have today also 441 nuclear power reactors in operation in 30 countries. And under construction in 2006, there were 67 new power plants under consideration in 50 countries. So that slide shows the nuclear capacity growth. And it was stopped like after Chernobyl accident, and then after acceleration, then again it was like plateau here, you see, after the Fukushima accidents here. Still, we have several projects on how power, nuclear power will develop, if it stays constant or developing more. For this, Galina will later today present in pro scenarios on this. And there are different estimations that are very difficult also to estimate. Excuse me. How, say, if you don't know the potential factors and demand and some, but still it's possible to estimate. Still, we could estimate how many, how can we develop these scenarios and how it finally should work. And we should be prepared. Knowing scenarios gives you idea how can you prepare to this. And also, if you look at this slide, it's regional development of nuclear power, which is very important. For example, in Western Europe and Eastern Europe, it's relatively in projections new, low estimates. So the blue one is low estimate and yellow is high estimate. Still, it's more or less stable. However, if you go to countries like India and China, thanks to these countries, and also other newcomers countries, especially for China. Okay. This doesn't work like expected, okay. So thanks to the China, for example, and India, these big countries will require a huge amount of energy, and we should just think that no hydropower or problem. Okay, we don't say that nuclear energy is a must here. It's a choice of the countries, but it's logical and it shows that it should be contribute. Nuclear energy can contribute to this development if we want those countries to be to reach the level of the rich countries of Western Europe and North America and Japan and other developed countries. Because, let's say, in India, consumption of electricity now is like 10 times less than in Europe. And China is already 2.5. It's more than India because China is developing well, but India will also develop very soon. And they will require a lot of energy. And the source of one of the source of this energy can be nuclear energy, of course. And this is general talk about IAEA. I just want to, our young generation, I would like to attract your attention to the fact that we also hire people, young, talented engineers and professionals in nuclear energy to the agency. And you can easily find the things, how to be employed by the IAEA. One example is Chirayu Batra, by the way, who was a very young, talented engineer who got a job, and I'm happy with his performance, and I hope he is not very, does hate his work in the IAEA, not yet, as well. And I invite you also to consider this possibility. If you have expertise, you can apply for the any positions which you can find on our website as well. Now I will explain a little bit about the details of the work we do in the fast reactor technology developing team. It's a very small team which is belong to the Department of Nuclear Energy. And within the Department of Nuclear Energy, we have Division of Nuclear Power, which is related to nuclear power and energy production. And we have Nuclear Power Technology Developing Section, which is goal and activity on advanced nuclear energy system. And within this section, we have fast reactor technology development team, which is, of course, doing for the, with this innovative, because most of the innovative nuclear energy system are based on the fast reactor technology, of course, for several reasons that Massimo will later explain in the details. However, not everything. And that's what we are, mission of our section and our team, to fulfill this slogan, Atoms for Peace and Development. So this slide shows our main activities. I know maybe I will skip it because of time, but this simply, these all presentations will be stored in the website of the ISTP also, and also on the our IAEA, so we can reach and learn something like that. We have several activities, and I will show you just generally what we are doing, and we're using so-called programmatic approach. One program is a modeling and simulation. It's mainly coordinated research projects, what we coordinate in the agency. I will talk later. Knowledge preservation. We have a fast reactor knowledge preservation portal, and we have several online structures and databases on different technologies. Education and training. This workshop is a part of this activity of educational training what we conduct. Safety, for the safety of the safety, in this case, technological safety. We work with several organizations. For example, we are closely work and we organize joint IAEA and GIF workshop on safety of the liquid metal cooled fast reactors. And technology support that includes several CRPs also. All these activities are covered by information exchange and international cooperation, of course, because we are the International Atomic Energy Agency. So our main activity, key activities, I would say, not main, but key activities, is coordinated research projects. And what is coordinated research project? This is some kind of scientific problem or benchmark of the experiment which several organizations gather together and conduct this research project under coordination of the IAEA. And to notice recently completed projects, it was BN600 MOX COA benchmark, analytical and experimental benchmark of accelerated driven systems, Phoenix end-of-life test benchmarks, we had two, and Mojo sodium circulation tests. Very recently finished, it was benchmark on shutdown heat removal test on EBR2 reactors in the US. Now we currently have ongoing, already two of several years, is NAPRA CRP, which related to sodium properties and safe operation of experimental facilities. As a result of this CRP, we have two textbooks already in printing or publishing, I would say, on sodium properties. And we still expect from our several participants a document and information on safe operation of the experimental facilities, which we hope to receive soon, as promised, and to publish the document also in our lifetime framework, at least. Okay. So, and just we started several new CRPs, and of them is Neutronic benchmark of CFR startup test, which we already have a first meeting of this, very interesting, I will talk a little bit later. And we are starting now another CRP, coordinated research project on benchmark analysis of the FFTF, loss of flow without scram test. CFR is China experimental fast reactor, and FFTF is fast flux test facility in the US. So to give you an idea how we are what is the CRP is, let's say we have this is slide shows no, something wrong here. This pointer, sorry. This slide shows the EBR2 reactor in the US structures, and what they did many years ago, in fact, when it was possible. They did several experimental tests, shutdown tests, protected, unprotected. For example, what happens if your pump if the pump stops and if the pump stop and what happened with the reactor core? As we know that we have a decay heat and also reactor works on power, is it automatically shut down or it's not shut down? How it works? We call it loss of flow accidents, or you have protected loss of flow accident, unprotected loss of flow accident. And that was studied experimentally on the sodium-cooled fast reactor EBR2 in the US. Then the results of the experiments were provided to the community, and several organizations from 20 organizations, actually from 12 countries jointly produced this. They calculated numerically, simulated this benchmark, first blindly without knowing the results, and then compared the results. And that gives them opportunity. It doesn't show which method or which software or which code is better. It provides the opportunity to validate their codes, to improve the model, to update, and to prove. This is the results. This plot shows us for the particular test the result of the benchmark. And you see we get together and compare many calculations from 20 organizations in this case of this complicated physical phenomenon. Another CRP what is ongoing now in the this is not validation because it's theoretical, I would say, hypothetical accident on the sodium-cooled fast reactor, which could lead to the radioactive release. You see that we have this, how can it be developed, for example? In principle, the sodium-cooled fast reactor has, due to this, fuel is not located, as we say, in most critical composition. So let's say if you remove sodium from the reactor, it will release mainly for the most reactor, sodium-cooled fast reactors, in the increase of the reactivity, and we can reactor can experience secondary power excursions, and fuel can melt inside. And what happens after that if you have a molten fuel inside the reactor? So this CRP starts from the assumption that due to the different consequences, which is Yulof accident usually, you have the molten fuel stored in the somehow the reactor with such with temperature and energy. We don't know how much it could be, but we assume that it's minimal and maximal case. And then what happens with the reactor? So you have the expansion phase. This molten fuel will expand, and this energy can be released as a mechanical energy as well, somehow destroying or increasing pressure in the reactor vessel. So the radioactive materials or sodium vapor could leave the reactor vessel through the gaps and through the other structures. This is one. First of all, you need to calculate how this bubble, I would say, I mean, what they say called bubble, will expand, shown in the first stage, and how much, finally, how much you will have sodium vapor, and what is the pressure of this sodium vapor? Approximately, of course, because you never know this exactly. Then, as you know this, as an initial condition for the second stage, you can calculate how this sodium vapor and radioactive gases, other also materials, would be released to the containment, and then how they will behave inside the containment. This is very complicated, as I say, hypothetical problem, which cannot be proved by the experiments for obvious reason, and I hope we'll never have a chance to validate such things. But we should understand what happens in the worst case, how can we mitigate, what can we do to prevent this also as well. But we should understand consequences of such hypothetical accident. And that is what was very complicated phenomena, physical. It's multi-physics. It includes several phenomena. It's validated by the team of the international expert. So NAPRO-CRP, it's about the sodium properties. In this project, it's not like benchmark. This is like collection of the available data on sodium. What do we know about sodium? What are the properties of the sodium? Density, heat capacity, other things. There are thousands of publications on this topic around the world. And our expert collected this material since 19th century, by the way, and tried to present them in an organized way, showing the reference, let's say, relations for the different sodium properties and range and everything. So this is one that is collected together, plus another, and this is, I mean, it's not easy. It was relatively easy because we have many publications and the task to collect, to analyze and assess this data and to provide the result. Another two tasks that we tried to do, it was also collect design rules and best practice for the sodium experimental facilities and to provide the guidelines for the safe operation of sodium experimental facilities. This is more complicated because it depends on the country, on the national rules, and there are no very open, really available open publications on this, so you have to, let's say, translate from French or from Russian and to get data together. You have to clear also, get a permission for publication. That is more complicated, and probably Christian will explain why it was not very successful, because he is leading this CRP. And still, I hope with his help and with his enthusiasm, we can conclude this successfully. But still, already to have this handbook on sodium physical and chemical properties, and handbook on sodium hydraulic correlations for the sodium coolants, is already successful CRP. There is a new CRP on neutronics benchmark of China experimental fast reactor startup test. This is a standard neutronics test which are conducted on every reactor, and CIA, Chinese Institute of Atomic Energy, agreed to provide the data for this benchmark, and many participants, like 26 or 27, decided to participate. They will compare their computer codes, like the different types, Monte Carlo codes and other codes also, and use this data to validate the models and computer codes. Very interesting CRP, and I'm sure that it will be good connections. Another new CRP is the benchmark analysis of the FFTF loss of flow without scrum test, so-called. FFTF is fast flux test facility, is a sodium-cooled fast reactor, was built in the USA, and like, I don't know, 20, maybe 30 years ago, they did experiments trying to demonstrate that this sodium-cooled fast reactor can survive several type of accident, including the unprotected loss of flow accident, which they call loss of flow without scrum test. So in this case, pump stop again. There were no automatic insertion of the control or shutdown rods. It was a state. But thanks to so-called gas expansion model, which is passive shutdown system, reactor survived this accident, and temperatures, final temperatures were within the limits. So this we can try to and in this case, PNNL and Argonne National Laboratory provided us data, decided to provide data on this. And now this database is available for the validation and for the benchmarking and validation of the simulation course of the participants. Very complicated. Again, this is a multi-physics phenomenon, includes neutronics, thermal hydraulics, and maybe material science, and system codes also can participate with simplified one of these options. This is what we do. Okay, about CRPs. I was talking about CRPs, which probably some of you already participate in this CRP, or you participate in the organization which are participants of these CRPs. Another important activity which we have, we organize the agency, the IAEA organized International Conference on Fast Reactors and Related Fuel Cycles. And we had already three conferences, one in Kyoto in 2009, one in Paris in 2013, and last year it was Fast Reactor, IAEA Conference on Fast Reactors and Reactors Fuel Cycle in Yekaterinburg in Russia, where just was brand new sodium-cooled fast reactor Ben and 100 was put in operation. So, and this conference attract a lot of attention of many experts and engineers and from all countries around the world, and I am proud that I contribute to organization of the latest conference in Yekaterinburg as well. So we conduct it every 4 years, like Olympic Games, I always say. And next conference will be in 2021. Still we don't know where, probably in Vienna also. And I invite you all to attend and to submit your paper and scientific work to that conference. So also to notice you that during the FR17, we had a young generation event, several events, I would say. It was, we were selecting the best presentation, and it was the award. Chirai organized that, and he knows very well how to organize, and we have, it was one award for the next generation nuclear systems, force awakeness. And it was a panel. There were several participants who participated in the panel, how the young people, young engineers like you, think and consider the development of nuclear power. Why do we need fast reactors? Do we need innovative nuclear system or not? That was a hot discussion also. And we had several presentations, and one was selected and awarded, actually, it was not money, but it was certificate signed by the Director General of the IAEA, which is also, I think, better than money sometimes. And also travel, the five winners, I would say, receive a travel support to the Yekaterinburg at that time. So experiment, this is, we also conduct and collect data on the several things, and this slide presents the experimental facilities database on liquid metal fast neutron system. This includes sodium-cooled reactors, lead-cooled and lead-bismuth heptactic-cooled reactors. Okay. Which is, this database is freely available from the IAEA website. You can, to find it, you can just search IAEA LMFNS after this, and you can get. Also, one of our main activities, I say, and most, one of very important activities is training courses and workshops. So we conduct different types, and especially this type of workshops in the joint workshops with ISTP and the IAEA, we conduct like once in 2 years already. And this, a couple of photos from the previous workshop, also in Trieste, if you know, you will be familiar with this place very soon. So I'm proud to say that we try to organize it in a very effective way, not only lectures, but also group activities, poster sessions, so you can conduct and communicate freely within your groups, with your lectures during the poster section, and any time that our lectures will support you during your group activities as well. And please use this chance to communicate together and communicate with other experts. And also, of course, with me, with us, with IAEA people here, if you need any help and so on. Okay. Thank you very much for your attention. And welcome to Trieste. We shifted a little bit our presentations to leave more room for the several other lectures. And I don't know, should we have a coffee break now, or we can, because it's scheduled for... group photo, let me check. 10:30 is coffee break and group photo, 15 minutes. I think we can start, go for the group photo now. It's in the front of the building, I believe, or with us come something, yeah, someone. And then have a coffee break, and then we continue our workshop with presentation made by Chirayu. It's a young generation view on history of nuclear energy. Okay, thank you for your attention.